Well, good morning. Thank y'all for being here this morning. COVID is a strange time, and we are coming to you this morning from my living room. And I'm here with Karen and Kevin. And we decided that since the gospel is very much about conversation between Jesus of Nazareth and the disciples, specifically a conversation between Jesus and Simon, yet to be called Peter, where Jesus asks the disciples and Simon, who are people saying that I am? And then he drills down into Simon specifically and says, yeah, but who do you say that I am? And so we thought that would be a good thing to talk about this morning. So thank you for being here, Karen, and coming over this morning. And I guess we'll just start with that. Who do you say Jesus is?
It is a thought-provoking question. And I think if I had to answer that question when I was 10 years old, it would be a very different answer than I have today. So when I went to church camp as a fifth grader, I felt really coerced into going to the altar call, which happened to be around the campfire. All the other kids had gone to the campfire, so I thought, I better go to this campfire too. It was all about accepting Jesus as your Savior. I didn't really know what that meant. I wasn't sure what I needed to be saved from, and I wasn't really sure who this Jesus was. And after that campfire event, the pastor's wife, who was a little overbearing, came to me and said, well, I knew you could run from me, but you can't run from Jesus. So I had this ingrained idea that Jesus was someone to be afraid of, someone scary and judgmental, and I wasn't sure what I had done. So I carried that thought about Jesus well into my young adulthood, that this Jesus was someone to be cautious about, a dangerous person. And I do believe Jesus is dangerous. Jesus calls us to do things that are difficult and beyond our human capabilities of doing. Jesus calls us to love those that are unlovable. Jesus calls us to stand up for the hard ride against the easy wrong. So Jesus is dangerous for sure. But as I've grown into my more mature years, I've come to know something different of Jesus. And I really developed that experience in walking with a friend through her last few months of life. We joked around about having a Jesus aversion. We were much more comfortable talking about God, but calling on Jesus' name was something kind of scary. And she desperately wanted that spiritual relationship before she died. So many, many, many hours of conversations led us to this place of she needed to call on the name of Jesus because that's where she was going. And then our Jesus aversion lifted and we realized that going to Jesus was a safe, comforting, life-giving place. A place full of mercy and grace and acceptance and love. A place of affirmation and empowerment. So I think I still live in the tension of Jesus being a dangerous person because of what Jesus models for us and calls us to do that's countercultural.
Sure, yeah.
And Jesus being a person full of mercy and grace who loves us and wants all good for us.
So can you say more about what that's been for you?
It's been liberating and it's been challenging. I think from my early impressions of Jesus, I never want to put that impression on anyone else. That Jesus is there to judge and condemn and be bearing down on anything they might be caught doing wrong or focusing on our sins and our shortcomings. I never want to pass that image of Jesus along to anyone. So I think it's an important foundation for me to have because I really want to err on the side of embodying Jesus as a grace-giving, loving, challenging, not a roll with the flow person, but a person who calls us to be so much bigger and more than we might otherwise be. To love in ways that are challenge our human capabilities, but make the world a far better place.
So do you feel like finding the liberation that's in Jesus has, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but do you feel like finding the liberation of Jesus has empowered you to be more risky in the call of Jesus?
What it reminds me of is one of my favorite compliments that I've ever received was this woman said to me, "I can breathe around you."
Oh, wow.
And I think having a relationship with Jesus has allowed me a level of comfort that people can breathe around me. All sorts and types of people.
That's really powerful. In many ways, you become, have become, are, I think, a conduit for the Christ. Does that make
That's
you nervous?
Powerful, isn't it? It's very humbling.
Mm.
And yes, it makes me a little nervous because I know my own shortcomings
sure.
and failures. And,
right. Yeah. And yet at the same time, I'm guessing because of the freedom that you found in that safe place, it allows you to let the Christ be breathe through you so others can breathe around you.
Wow.
It's pretty powerful. It is. It's really cool. Good for
so
you.
So what about you, Kevin? Who do you say Jesus is?
So I got asked this question recently in this assessment retreat that I'm taking around church planting, and it really caught me off guard, frankly, the being asked. So tell us about your experience of Jesus. Who is Jesus to you? And it took me a while to kind of, like I think you've said, to get beyond. My initial response was, oh, I don't, that's too, you know, preachy, too Jesus-y, too, because that's not our tradition. That's not my way of relationship with the Christ. But then, once I let that question settle into my soul, who do I say Jesus is? And what is my Jesus encounter? I was reminded, really recollected, the experience that I've had, that I've actually called on a variety of time in my life. I got into centering prayer quite a few years ago, and you know, it takes practice, right? It just didn't like one of those things that pops in, and you have to work at it and practice. And then one morning I was praying, and I finally got to that quiet place in which all the distractions were gone, and my ego was gone, and my fear was gone, and my anxiety around this all was gone, and my need to control and plan and make things happen was gone, and I was able to just be. And I found myself standing on the edge of it was like a mountain lake. I mean, completely calm water. No ripples, no currents, no, it was just completely calm. And this crazy color of blue that I've never seen before. And the lake just went on and on and on to really infinity. And then as I walked into the water, I found myself walking into the water. And at some point, I literally became one with the water. which was just pure peace. I don't even have, that's the closest word I can come to it. It's just, you know, we talk about the joy that passes all understanding. And that's the closest I think I can get to describing that, which it was just a pure calmness, a peace, an okayness, safety. And I realized that this was the Christ. This was Jesus. And you know, in those moments when I'm feeling really unsettled or afraid or like really afraid. If I'm purposeful about it, I can go back to that space, even if it's just for an instant, and find Jesus, and find that peace, that safety, that breath, I think, that you talked about, right? I can breathe. And I gotta tell you, it has literally saved my life on occasion. And so when we talk about Jesus as Savior, I don't know, I'm reading a book by a guy named Sam Wells who talks about the church has talked about three different purposes of Jesus. The first purpose of Jesus that the church globbed onto was this idea that of the afterlife, right? That we die and that the struggle, the problem is death. And therefore Jesus saves us from death and moves us into the afterlife. And the second purpose that the church has kind of globbed on is that the problem is sin, right? And that Jesus then saves us from sin. And his argument is that really the problem is isolation. That we find ourselves alone, completely disconnected. And in that disconnection, that aloneness, that isolation, all that. I mean, you said yourself, you said, I know my own shortcomings, right? And so in that isolation, all those things percolate up and becomes very untenable. And that the purpose of Jesus, the Christ, the effect of the Christ is about pulling us back into relationship, back into being.
Having enough grace for ourselves that we can extend that grace to others.
Yeah.
Not be afraid of being caught making a mistake or being caught being weak, but trusting that in those weaknesses and mistakes, Christ's mercy and grace is powerful.
Yeah. And knowing that, having that experience, right? Being able to go back to that moment with your friend June and say, I'm going into Jesus. Yeah. I can breathe. Finally. Yeah. And my experience about just being completely one with the peace.
And it seems that peace is an experience that not only serves you well in this crazy world and these untenable times, but that peace can flow through you to those around you.
I hope so. When I remember.
Yeah.
When I take the time to remember. That's my problem. Right? I don't think I'm alone with that problem.
No, not at all.
Yeah. When I take the time to remember, to remember, to make it real again. That's exactly right.
So it is. It's a powerful gospel.
I think so.
I think it's a question that is not easily answered or quickly answered, but a question that's important because it really is a foundation of who we are as Christians, who we say Jesus is.
Right.
So I would say to you all tuned in today, who do you say Jesus is?